Welcome to the 10th and last session in the first series of the advanced course, The Vital Approach. In this session, we will unfold the mysterious characteristics of viruses and bacteria remedies. These species accompany humanity without being seen with the naked eye, yet they produce numerous diseases or they are indispensable for some of our functions, for instance, our digestion. How do we know that a patient needs a remedy from this kingdom? What are the themes that enable us to define whether we have to do with the remedy in the virus or the bacteria section? This will be clear to you after you have finished this session. Enjoy! You gave valuable information about the general features of the main kingdoms. With these practical hints and tips, homeopaths can easily spot the mineral, animal or plant case. But there are more than these three kingdoms. Can you tell us more about the others?
Sure. In the first three sessions, I told you that these classifications and these categories were a work in progress. And of course it's obvious, or it's natural to start with the most obvious one, that we have these categories in biology and chemistry, and so that's why we started with plants, minerals and animals. But the other groups that we can define are, so far, nozotes, that's a well-known group, nozotes and sarcodes. We have the fungi and we have the imponderables. These are the other groups. So the imponderables, the last group, is a group where we put all the remedies that we cannot put in any other group. So we cannot have a classification of them and we call them altogether imponderables. And there are remedies like Coca-Cola, Luna, polystyrene, X-ray, Sol, etc. You know, those kind of magnet, those kind of remedies. The fungi, by some, are considered a separate group and by others are incorporated in the plant kingdom. And then we have the nozotes, and I distinguish two separate groups in the nozotes.
Mm-hmm. We can see that in your schemes, where you have keywords for miasma nozotes and other keywords for monera. Can you clarify on that?
Well, you know, in the nozotes, as we used to prescribe them classically, we do this on the basis of a few indicators. First one is, of course, when we have the full picture. We have a good proving of the remedy and we have the full remedy picture in the patient. So that's one indication, that's a clear one. But often, a nozote is used as an intercurrent remedy, especially when we clearly perceive a heavy ancestral load in the patient, or we use it as a deblockator when the case is stuck and to provoke reaction, or we use it as a remedy to make an unclear picture clear. Very often we have an unclear picture and then a nozote will clarify the picture, and often homeopaths use a nozote to finish a case, to close a case, as they say. So all this is still legitimate and proved beneficial for our patients, but unless the nozote was prescribed on the full picture, it wasn't considered as a constitutional remedy. It was like a remedy in between. And then with Sankaran's interpretation of miasms, we drifted away from the classical understanding of miasms altogether. And for a long time, I couldn't make sense of those two distinct interpretations that only seem to share the words, the name, but not the underlying meaning. The Hahnemannian miasms, in their classical interpretations, were understood as inherited weaknesses, tendencies, weaknesses, with a focus on the physical. And Sankaran miasms, with their understanding of classifications of delusions and the coping up mechanisms, is all mind stuff. The difficulty was that both make a lot of sense, and it wasn't difficult in daily practice to find proof for both. through my understanding of the vital sensation expressing itself on mind and body, I could fit in the both interpretations without having to choose. So this was good, yeah. So it seems to me that level 2, the energy level, we discussed this when we talked about the schemes, represent the vitality, the functional aspect of the physical. We explained this. So it is represented by the immune system, the hormonal system, the neurological system, and the energy system of the body. So it is the invisible, functional aspect of the body. And I think, as according to my understanding, this is the target of the Hahnemannian miasmatic load. The material body is not only the tangible, measurable aspect, because that is only level 1. That's level 1. But it's also the qualitative aspect. And that is what I consider level 2. And we also have in our bodies this miasmatic signature of level 2. For instance, tuberculinum, as we know, the tubercular personality has a quick metabolism, so we could call this a generality. And this is not tangible, but it is a feature of the physical of the tuberculinum person. And for instance, the psoriatic person with his deficiencies has a general tendency of coldness and slowness. And it's something you cannot really see under the microscope. But it's a generality of all psoriatic personalities. So we can see this is also inherited. But that's a qualitative aspect. And as we already discussed, the second level resonates with the second dimension. And in my understanding, the second dimension is the dimension of the dense world under our feet, under the surface of the earth. And where you find the minerals, the elements, the crystals, the building blocks, you can say, and the primitive organisms like the viruses and bacteria. So some people even go so far that we are actually made up from our building blocks and the bacteria, and that we contain so many in our body that we actually are bacteria bags. I wouldn't go so far. I think it's a little bit exaggerated, but it's true that we have a large percentage, or we contain a large percentage of bacteria, but I think we are more than the sum of our building blocks and constituents. So we don't only have these building blocks and these bacteria in ourselves, in our physical body, but we also have their, I would call it their spirit, of all these separate beings in our body. We contain this in our body. And if we are not in harmony with them, then we are prone to all kind of disturbances, like deficiencies or functional disturbances, metabolic disturbances, hormonal dysfunctions, problems with the immune system, imbalances with our energy, a lot of problems we see in our daily practice, because a lot of patients suffer from, in my understanding, level 2 problems, which are a difficulty for the general practitioner, because you cannot measure them. People complain about it, but there's no real disease. They cannot diagnose it as a real disease. Basically, as far as I understand, there are three main disturbances possible in your energy level. One is with the amount of energy. You have mostly not enough. Most people will complain of not enough, and that's the lack, the deficiency of the sora. You can have problems with the distribution, with uneven distribution, and that belongs to the psychotic miasm, the personality we know as one of extremes. It's not enough or too much. And then you can have a problem with the nature of your energy, which is syphilitic, and it's a destructive nature, like in HDAD, where there is a lot of energy, but it's destructive, and it's not useful to the person. His energy is chaotic, it goes in all kind of different directions, so it is unfocused and is destructive. That's an example of destructive energy. Another one is autoimmune diseases, where the energy of the immune system, where the action of the immune system is pointed toward the person.
I see. That's why Hanuman Vyasma's list is on level 2 mm-hmm. and Sankaran Vyasma's list is on level 4. Because the illusion is in the mind, and while energy belongs to the level 2.
Exactly. That is why a patient can have a different miasm on the mind than on the body. For instance, it's very well possible that somebody is tubercular, as I told you, with his tubercular traits, but also with the mind, he can have this need to travel and for change and everything. Yet, it's possible on the physical level, you find a more psoric or a more psychotic tendency. So it happens that there are two different miasms in one person.
Mm-hmm. The classic miasms are only three, so the combinations must then be probably occur in the mind.
That could be an explanation, because it's more refined, sure. But we don't know. We still have to do a lot of research and try to make sense of our observations and define the rules.
What is the importance of all this for the Manira Kingdom?
Well, I had to tell you all this, and in the previous session I had to explain all about the Sankaran miasms in order to make clear what I mean with these two groups of nozots. As we did, and I always do, I still do actually, is to find the similibum in every case. That's what I'm always trying. And it occurred to me, in some patients, whatever you ask them, the last answer always seemed to be the coping up mechanism. This we can call, you know, the heart of the miasm. I gave you all the characteristics in the previous session. And the last answer, the last feeling, the last explanation always seemed to be the heart of the miasm. For instance, there was a patient and with the blocked nose, of course, our classical blocked nose cases. And when I asked her to explain more and more, she was a meduodenum case, which has this typical complaint. Once it's there, it never goes away. It's a fixed problem. And her attitude was, well, I have to live with it. I there's nothing I can do about it. I try this and I try that and the other. Nothing helps, so I learned to accept it then. It's not that bad. After all, it only takes an hour in the morning, then it clears a bit, and then my nose is not running, but I have to live with it. What can you do? The doctor said it's not a real disease, and it will pass, but it doesn't pass, etc. So whatever I asked her was live with it, avoid problems, hide it, don't talk about it, accept it. And when she talked about her friends, she had a few friends, she was a girl at 16, 18 years old, so the other part of the interview was about friends, that's normal. But the attitude was the same, like a friend behaved a bit funny and she wasn't happy with it, but she accepted that friend had problems at home and that's why she acted. Same words came up, accepting, live with it, not talk about it, etc. Nothing you can do about it, the problem is like it is fixed. What else can you do? Then give meduodenum. It's meduodenum in mind, meduodenum in body. And it's the coping up mechanism that's always on the foreground. Another patient, another example was a carcinosin woman who actually had cancer. And the main thing was that she didn't want the family members to notice. Can you imagine? She had operations, she had chemotherapy. And she didn't want her children to notice. Everything should be normal, like always. So she was under control. Her feelings was under control. Her household was under control. The feelings of her children were under control because she wanted to control how they would feel about her disease. But in the beginning, it was not that clear. Well, it was clear that it was cancer miasm. But then you go look for the sensation, right? And she seemed to be a very sensitive woman. So I asked her more and more, and she told me about her mother, and there was a problem with her mother. How is your feeling? How is your feeling? She was hurt by the words of her mother. So it's in composite, great. Then a bit more stories about her family, and something happened with the daughter, and how was your feeling? How did you experience it? And she said, well, it was a shock. I didn't expect my daughter to behave like it. So shock. great, plant sensation, but well, it's a different one. And then as the consultation went on and on, she was telling about her garden, because she loved gardening. And but it was a small garden, and she told them all details. What was the feeling? Because she had a feeling of joy there, yet she felt stuck. So another one. And that's a clear hint, if you have these different sensations, because you asked for the sensations, they didn't come spontaneously, they didn't hold, they didn't come back, so they were once, they were not repeated, and you have different ones from different families, then you know it's not a plant. It's not another plant yet, it's just not a plant. You get sensations, but they are actually common human feelings, and they were appropriate to the situation, and they were explicable because she was sensitive, so it was normal that she felt these things when in this story she told. And the only thing you were left with was the meisen, the control in every situation. Even with the hurt, in the story of her mother, she controlled her hurt and didn't show. Mm-hmm. Even with the shock with her daughter, she didn't show. Mm-hmm. Nobody knew that she was shocked. Mm-hmm. So the control was the one thing that held, and that's, for me, a clear carcinosum case, and only in this case, I think we have a level 5 carcinosum case. Mm-hmm. That's how I understand it. So these are the kind of cases I would call the miasm nosode cases. They have the heart of the miasm, and the main thing in the case is the signature of this miasm. Mm-hmm. So the only thing they display in the whole case is their coping mechanism. Whatever you ask, how did you feel? How did you experience this? Again and again you feel, what, a bit more, tell me a bit more, you know, or our questions to get deeper and deeper. All you get, all the last answer is always, it's either control, it's avoid, it's accept, it's change, and it's nothing there, nothing more. And those are the miasm nosode cases.
In fact, we are familiar with these group of nosodes, but you differentiate them from what you call monerum, although these remedies are also made from bacteria as well.
So, with a few exceptions, yes, nobody really knows what psoriasis is made of. And carcinosin is a tumor tissue, so it's not a bacterium or a virus. So for me, this is another proof that homeopathy is mainly symbolic, because those two don't behave any different than all the others. So they do just their job, they do the same. So they represent a nosode, and that's enough. Maybe psora is a different story altogether, because psora, it's hard to tell what it stands for. Maybe it's only chronicity. Mm-hmm. That could be the understanding of psora, as it, not a separate syndrome or a disease, but chronicity in itself. Mm-hmm. Now the group of monera is quite easy to spot if you know what you're looking for. Mm-hmm. We already knew from the Joshis, other Indian homeopaths, that there is a polarity, because they understand cases in polarities, and the polarity in nosode cases, in their understanding, is the polarity between health and disease. So the person is, his main focus is on being sick, being diseased, and trying to get healthy. Mm? And they will talk about this exclusively throughout consultation, maybe with a little exception. Some patients are good patients, and they went to other homeopaths before. And then they know what the homeopaths expect, because the homeopaths ask them many questions about their childhood, and the father and the mother, and their brothers and sisters, and their relationship. So they think that is what the homeopaths need to know, and then they will talk about these things spontaneously. If you say anything else, they will say, well, you know, my childhood was very difficult. And you get those stories. And this is a bit unreliable. Or the patient went in psychotherapy, same story. In psychotherapy, it's always about the past and what happened to the in the past, and what did it do with you, and explaining why you're feeling how you feel now because of things happened in the past. So the danger is that the patient will give you all these psychological interpretations of their biography. Or maybe that's even worse, the patient is a homeopath. So, you know, then they know that you will need the sensation. And they will come up with all kinds of sensations, and these are even worse because you might get caught in the trap, and then you lost it. Because they think that physical information is only level 1 and 2, see? Mm-hmm. And they want to come up with level 5 information, and, mm-hmm. and you will get a confused case. But let's say in general, the patient talks about his physical complaints in length. And I mean in all detail. And mostly it's functional problems. So they have often a lot of diagnoses. Like they have and chronic fatigue syndrome, and fibromyalgia, and they have sleeping apnea, and they have a lot of food intolerances, and they have irritable bowel syndrome, and spastic colon, and a burnout on top of that, and multiple bursitis, and they have eczema, and urticaria, and etc., etc. So you have pages and pages and pages and pages of physical symptoms, or they have no diagnosis. Or an unclear diagnosis. There's something with these many diagnoses, strange diagnoses, in itself is strange and peculiar. It's not a straightforward diagnosis. Eh? Or they have a lot of systemic diseases on top of that, like fibrosis with vague terminology, mucosis, or hormonal imbalances, or spasmodic muscle tone, something like that. This generalized functional unclear problems, and in general they have a lot of sensitivities. So they are sensitive to wind, they're sensitive to cold, sensitive to rain, sensitive to snow, sensitive to draft, name it. Eh? And as I said, a lot of food intolerances, all kinds of food. They're sensitive or intolerant to wheat, to milk, to citrus fruit, to alcohol, to nuts, to sugar, etc., etc. They can't stand additives, preservatives, exhaust, they have nickel allergy, they can take penicillin, it sounds familiar, right? Colorants, perfume, cigarette smoke, etc. So that again will be a whole list, and usually you get so much information when you take the physical symptoms, when you do the intake, and pages and pages, and on top of that, all their visits to doctors, what the doctor said, and to this doctor, and that doctor, and the other, and other therapists, and a lot of examinations, and a lot of results of the examinations, and a lot of treatments, and a lot of medication, and you get the idea that's their whole life. From morning till night, 24 hours on 24 hours, they have to focus on their physical health in order to function. They have to be careful, they have to do this and they have to avoid the other, just in order to more or less do what they have to do. And even when they are functioning, it will be poor and limited, and they will need a lot of rest. And I mean with a lot, like a lot. Mm-hmm. 16 hours. They will have to sleep for 10 hours, and even during the day they will need some rest, and in between then they can, if they can, they will work, but they will need all their free time to recuperate. And if they work, maybe it's half time, so they do less than, let's say, average, and they have the need to rest much more than average, and in proportion or disproportion to the effort. So they always have to calculate, will I be able to do this, will I be able to socialize, will I be able to perform, will I be able to meet my appointments, because they never know how they will be the next day. Maybe this will be a problem, or it will be too cold, or they will have an upset stomach, or they will have a headache, or they will have some pain here or there. They'll never know. There's always something, and every day they will have to struggle to get through the day. And in the end of all their information, they will tell you, but that is normal, is it? Mm-hmm. And of course it isn't. They compare themselves to other people, what other people can and do, and what they only can and do, with so much problem, mm-hmm. so much troubles, so much pain and illnesses. So it isn't normal, and that's the other thing. The feeling, the experience of all these problems is I'm not normal. Healthy people are normal and do what they do, they live their life. And I'm not normal because I'm sick. They're normal because they're healthy.
The image or picture seems to fit a lot of our patients though, maybe the hypochondriac patient.
Maybe at first sight, yes. But there's more to it in Monera cases, of course, than only the report of the disease. And even in that way, they are not really hypochondriacs because they don't have this typical anxiety for health because actually it's their reality. It's not a delusion or a fear that is exaggerated. They don't exaggerate the symptoms. Actually, they give you the clear report of all the problems they have. So that's a difference because hypochondriacs, very often they fear something they don't have. They feel extra heartbeat and they say, I have a heart attack, those kind of people. Eh? Mm-hmm. So it is a kind of matter of fact report of what they really are suffering of. So they don't exaggerate, but they relentlessly try to improve their health. They don't feel well, not sick enough to stay in bed, not well enough to function, and they will always try to improve or try to cope or try to find some help, something that a good advice. They will always try a new diet because they are on the search of the perfect diet for them. They believe in food, they believe in diets for them, and sometimes they will give lots of money for all additives and how to say supplements, vitamins, special food, healthy food, or that makes you strong, or the last panacea in the health store. They will always go for that, and they have a focus on food anyway. That's typical for bacteria. Bacteria and viruses are in basically very primitive organisms. That is not a judgment of our patients. But the sensation in them, bacterial sensation, makes them focused on very basic issues like food, eat, sleep, grow, activity, and rest. Very, very basic things.
Will they talk about these things?
Food, most likely, because it's a very popular topic. Everybody likes to talk about food. We have to eat 3 times a day, at least, so... And a lot of people believe that you are what you eat and pay a lot of attention to their food, or they enjoy food a lot, which is another aspect of it, of course. And on top of that, diets do have spectacular reactions. Mostly only the first 3 weeks, but everybody can experience what you can do when you change your diet. When you leave out some food that you are used to, you will have a very clear reaction, and it doesn't matter what you leave out. And of course, a blend diet without toxins will make you feel completely different. Everybody can experience that, but mostly our body adapts quite quickly, and after a few weeks, the body does its normal things with the food it gets. Even if it's different food. And that's something that I think also people can experience. But the first reaction is very spectacular. So that enforces the idea that you can do miracles with diets. And since they are already very much interested in food, you can understand the topic. And a lot of homeopaths, by the way, are interested in food or think food is very important. For your health, we are in the health business. So this most likely will be something that is discussed, but you feel that your patient is a bit more than average interested, and is more than average occupied with trying diets, and they will try only fruit diets, and then they will try macrobiotic diets, and then they will leave out all toxins, no coffee, no sugar, no tea, no alcohol, etc. And still they feel sick and out of energy, and so that's not the solution. The growing, because that's another aspect of the Monera, how will that be expressed? Mostly And it's more prominent in viruses than in bacteria.
Mm-hmm.
They will talk about their interests. And they have an interest in expanding and growing. And the language fair is very much the same as any manager in a modern company.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's what they want to do. They want to expand, they want to grow, they want to become more, they want to become bigger, they want to incorporate mm-hmm. the other, eh?
Mm-hmm.
They want to become one, the other one will be dissolved.
Mm-hmm.
Eh? It's like that. Eh? So this is the kind of language you can expect from grow.
Mm-hmm.
So this is another aspect that you can find in more in bacteria, more in viruses than in bacteria.
Mm-hmm.
I can give you an example of one of the patients that needed a Monera
mm-hmm.
as a constitutional remedy. And she was a woman in her 40s, I think, who loved to travel.
Mm-hmm.
And she went to different continents. She went to South America and to India. And she was talking about the influence you have on your environment when you come there, because they're, you know, they have a focus on influence. Eh? And she said the environment is never the same after you've been there, etc. But in a while, in a short while, actually, things will become as home. Hmm? In the beginning, it's mm-hmm. all new and it's changing and it's changing you and it, you change the environment, but after a while, it becomes daily stuff. Like at home, daily mm-hmm. routine. And I said, okay, what will you do then? Oh, she said, you sleep, you wake up, you eat, you walk a little bit, you eat, you have a little rest, you walk a bit more, you eat, and you go to sleep. And it was a bit surprising that in her idea, that is what you do. That is daily life. And that's the daily life from the point of view of a Monera.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very basic.
Mm-hmm. So, is there something like a Monera mind picture?
There sure is, but it's not well represented or not represented at all in our classical Materia Medica, in our rubrics or in our software. But from cases, yes, I can give a few hints
mm-hmm.
On top of all the things we said so far on the Monera mind. From the cases, I can tell that in Monera there's a kind of submissiveness, obsequiousness, a kind of, it's more than yielding, it's a servile attitude, and it will be expressed in a particular way. The patient will give you the report of all these diseases, and you will notice that they'll follow the instructions, but they follow the instructions from the one and from the other, even if they are contradictory. So that will occur to you, that's a bit strange, and this therapist said this and the other doctor said that. Or they have, or they follow what they heard from hearsay.
Mm-hmm.
But everybody knows, or people say, oh, I read in the newspaper that, and then it can be anything.
Mm-hmm.
That sugar is not good for you, you should eat more fat, you should, etc., etc. You know, all these things that we hear from people and read that, and on the television, all this good advice. And they follow a lot of those mm-hmm. things. But during consultation, it will occur to you that it doesn't make any logical pattern. And you're looking for a pattern that will see what is what holds throughout the case.
Mm-hmm.
What is the pattern that make up the patient. But there is no logical pattern mm-hmm. in this Monera case. And you will ask yourself, where is he? So what does he stand for? And when you ask direct questions, because you can ask your patient. If you don't understand, you can say, well, in the beginning you said this, and now you said that, and I don't quite understand how these two things go together.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell a bit more? Then you will get another illogical explanation.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that they will explain it, because sometimes it happens,
mm-hmm.
that the patient said, oh, okay, I wasn't very clear. With this I meant so and so and so, and then you see it is logical.
Mm-hmm.
It's only not well expressed yet or not clear yet. But in the Monera case, they will give you something more illogical. And so you, on top of it, it's a confirmation
mm-hmm.
that it is illogical and it stays illogical. So you ask yourself at the end, but in yourself, you don't have to ask your patient, what does he stand for?
Mm-hmm.
What is his opinion? Where is he? Where is he set there? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Does he have a vision at all? Mm-hmm. Does he have an own will or not? And that is what I mean with this submissive, but also this weak-willed, like they have no own will, no own idea, no own center, mm-hmm. Which actually is true. In reality, mm-hmm. The species doesn't have a center. But that's the way it's expressed in your patient.
Mm-hmm. It sounds as if this is difficult to define in a patient.
Because we try to make sense of a case that doesn't make sense, mm-hmm. which we shouldn't do, mm-hmm. but it's so natural. And by doing this, we lose the case. Eh? And we make a case, we make an unsensible case, a sensitive one, but sensible one. But when you, in consultation, only follow the patient, only go into detail in the topics, into the topics that he brought, and no other topics. And we try to understand how he experiences whatever he told. And his complaints, then it will become clear. You know, the answers in themselves, they all sound logical. They're possible in themselves. But, and they do make sense. But it's only like facts. You ask something and it seems as if you only get facts. Or you only get quotes from the others. Well, my pharmacist says, or well, my doctor says, or I read in the newspaper, in this health article about whatever bursitis, that you should never or you should. It's only quotes from other people. And while you're asking from, how is your experience? What do you think? What do you feel? How do you cope? Eh? And I'm sure a lot of those cases, the majority of those cases are still considered superficial. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, these are only fact level cases. Mm-hmm. Level one, level two. Nothing you can do with them, you cannot make a decent prescription, useless cases. Well, in fact, they give you a clear, vital sensation of a murderer. Mm-hmm. But you have to know what you're looking for. And while we're looking for something deep, or something special, that's a danger. Eh? Mm-hmm. We miss the whole case that is displayed in front of our eyes. Mm-hmm.